Research Design Lab.
Hello everyone. In this video, I will be demonstrating the various interfaces present on this PIC development board. There are a lot of cool stuff present on this board. So make sure you buckle up till the end so that you could make maximum usage of this board. Let's start with the power socket. This board could be powered on by connecting a 12-volt transformer or an adapter with 12-volt ratings. Here is a slide switch which could be used to turn on or turn off the power supply on this board. Next, let's look into the IC base section here. The ZIF socket here could be used to mount almost all 40-pin PIC 16F and 18F IC series. You just need to unlock the socket and place the IC on top of it and turn down the lever parallel to the ZIF socket. The pinouts of the IC have been printed parallel to the male headers where you could make easy connections using jumper wires. This here will be a reset key which could be used to reset your PIC microcontroller. And this here will be an ISP connector using which you can dump the code directly into the IC mounted on the ZIF socket. Let's learn how to burn codes into the IC. To begin with, we need to create the code first. Let's use the sample code present in the product page. I shall use LED keypad code which changes the sequence of 8 LEDs. There are various compilers in which you can write your codes. Most common ones being MPLAB and Micro C Pro for PIC. I'm more into Micro C Pro, so I shall use the same compiler for the demonstration of codes on this board. Here, let me just copy the code and paste it in my compiler software after completion of the initial setups. Save and build the code to check for any errors. So now the code has been successfully compiled. Next we need to do is dump the code into the hardware or the PIC IC. For this we need this additional programmer which creates an interface between a computer and the development board. Just connect the programmer to your computer using this USB A to B cable and connect your FRC cable end to the ISP socket present on the development board. Make sure your IC has been detected by the software. You could use check communication option to do the same. Once the IC has been detected, import the hex file from your computer hard disk to the burner software and hit write. The software indicates the status of code getting burnt into the IC. Wait until the software finishes the burning process. Please note, we need to supply power to the board so that you may be able to burn the code into the IC. Also, there are enough PIC IC burners available which you could use to burn the codes into the PIC IC. Now let me make the connection on this board using these female jumper cables. To know which pins are being used, kindly refer the code. In this code, entire port B is given to LEDs, so let's connect 8 jumper cables between the LEDs and port B. Also, there are 4 inputs which are given to a set of keys. For now, I shall connect these to 1x4 push buttons present on the development board. Let's power on the board and see what happens. As you can see, these LEDs are just getting toggled in an orderly manner. Now I shall press and hold the first key. You can notice the LED sequence has been changed. Now if I press the second key, I will have a different sequence for the LEDs. Same is true for the other two keys as well. If you want to change the LED sequence to your choice, then you just need to change a few lines in the code. You don't need to be a rocket scientist to do it. It's really easy to write a simple I/O code. If you have noticed already, there's a drawback while using these push buttons as your input keys. Basically, you need to press and hold the switch to keep its state on. To avoid this, we have this DIP switches here. Let me just turn off the supply and connect the switch jumper cables to the DIP switch headers. Now, if I want to change the sequence of LEDs, I just need to change the slide switch status of the respective DIP connector, eliminating the need to press and hold the switch. Let me just slide down the switch and slide up the second switch. You can see the LED sequence changing. Let me explain what's happening here. These here are push button switches, meaning you need to keep the buttons pushed to change its state. So whenever you press this button, a high voltage or plus 5 volt is sent across the respective pin. Same logic applies for the DIP switches, except for the fact that it holds the logic high status as long as the slide switch maintains its state. Let's move on to the LCD headers here. Basically, you can mount a 16x2 LCD module here. By using these headers, you can connect your LCD IOs to any port pins of your PIC microcontroller using a bunch of female jumper cables. Next here, we have a few variable resistors, or you may call them pots or presets. Basically, the output of this is an analog voltage varying from 0 to 5 volt. So if required, you can connect this to one of the analog pin of your PIC microcontroller and check for its corresponding digital value. Let me demonstrate this with the help of a sample code. As you can see, when I vary this preset, the digital value varies. The same logic applies to the other two presets as well. Again, to know about the connection details, kindly go through the code available in the product page. Next, this here is a monophonic buzzer, just in case if you need an audio notification. You could use this by connecting a port pin to your PIC IC to the header here. This here is an EEPROM IC which could be accessed through I2C protocol, just in case external EEPROM is required. Moving on to RTC or real-time clock. This basically stores information of time and date even when the power supply of the board has been removed, but provided you place a CMOS cell here. Next, this here is a 1x4 7 segment display. Basically, it can display numbers. You can access each segment by cutting the voltage to ground to the corresponding headers here, implying it has a common anode connection. However, there are 4 such 7 segment multiplexed to common headers. So we have this active low select lines to select which 7 segment display you want to use. For example, if you want to display a number on the first display here, then you need to keep the header DIG1 to low and remaining 3 headers to high. This could be done by setting high or low state to any 4 port pins of your microcontroller. Let me demonstrate this by displaying time on this by using the RTC present on board. Please note, we need to place a CMOS cell on this cell holder while working with RTC. As you can see, there is some random time being printed on the 7 segment display. By using a little of coding skills, you could modify a few lines in the code and set the time to your meridian. Even if you turn off the power supply to your development board, the RTC will still store the correct time. This is because the RTC IC here takes its power supply from the CMOS cell during standby mode. Next, we have a 4x4 keypad. We have 8 headers for this keypad. C1, C2, C3, C4 and R1, R2, R3, R4. To know how this works, consider this keypad as a matrix having 4 rows and 4 columns. If I mark the index for this key, then it resides on the first row and first column. This key here is placed at first row and second column. This sequence continues for other keys. Basically, how it works is, when you press the first key, C1 and R1 will have continuity. Similarly, if you press the last key, C4 and R4 will have continuity. By this logic, you can write a code and work on your project. Apart from these interfaces, we also have this ZigBee footprint, using which we can easily mount a ZigBee module on top of it. Parallel connections to the device can be taken by using these male headers placed here. Next, we have this I2C bus so that we can connect an external I2C interface to this board. Technically, it's just a 1-to-1 jumper node. So basically, we need to connect jumper cables to the required port pins of your IC. Also, we have a similar interface for SPI as well. This here will be an interface to FT232 breakout board. Next, we have a ULN2803 IC driver interface. Just in case, if we have a device working at voltage beyond 5 volt, but then these devices may be needed to control through the PIC IC's IOs, which has a high voltage of 5 volt. The ULN2803 IC has a tolerance up to 12 volt. So any voltage between 5 to 12 volt shall do fine to work on this driver IC. Next, we have a 26 pin header, which comes in handy if you need to interface your Raspberry Pi to the interfaces present on the board. You just need a 26 pin FRC cable to connect the headers accordingly to the pin outs on the Pi board. But do remember to connect a common ground connection from your Raspberry Pi to the development board ground. Next, we have Arduino shield headers. These headers could be used to mount your Arduino shield on this board and can be used to interface the shield to the PIC development board. As you can see, we can easily mount this GSM shield. Corresponding headers are parallel to the board, so you can easily make the necessary connections. Same goes for the Bluetooth relay shield or LCD shield, or for that matter any other Arduino shield. Apart from these headers, there are few other things you may be interested in, like this 5V and ground headers, which supplies 5V and ground in their respective pins. There's also a 12V header here. Then we have a few jumper nodes with variable header lengths. There's one last thing which I missed out earlier, the serial data or UART protocol. This here is a DB9 female connector which could be used to interface your PIC IC to your device working with serial data. Please note the fact that you need to place two jumper connectors on both RX and TX connections parallel like this. This option was enabled for the reason that in case if you need a TTL to RS232 converter, you can use this same board by placing jumper wires on these headers. Let me explain this a bit more clearly. These two top headers are connected to RC6 and RC7, that is pin 25 and pin 26 of PIC ICs, which are the IC's hard serial pins. And these two headers are connected to MAX232 11 and 12 pins. So if you need your PIC IC to send data through MAX232, then there should be a jumper placed on these headers which enables the continuity between the PIC IC and the MAX232 IC serial pins. I hope I'm clear on all the interfaces present on the board. There's one more additional interface on board which comes as an optional choice, that is you can connect your USB mini cable directly to this board and convert your TTL data to USB or vice versa by making use of these headers here. But please note, this feature is optional, so choose your board wisely. Well, these are all the things present on the board. If you are a newbie to this board, then please note you may require the following things: a PIC IC burner, a power supply adapter. An adapter with 12V and a minimum of 2A current rating is preferred. You can use adapters with lesser current ratings as well, provided you are only using interfaces which use low current. Female to female jumper cables, a lot of them. Sample codes which you can download them for free from our product page. A 40-pin PIC 16F or 18F IC. A PIC software ID like MPLAB or Micro C Pro for PIC. And of course, something which money can't buy is your programming skills. I know it's been a tiring session, but thanks for making it till the end. If you have any more queries, please post it in the comment section below. And happy coding, folks.